Romantic comedies are toxic.
No, they're not. Romantic comedies are the spoonful of sugar that makes complex, universal relationship truths go down.
This is Take Two,
a series brought to you by The Take,
where we compare two opposing sides to a cultural debate of our times.
Today's big question, do rom-coms teach us how to love?
Take One will argue that no, rom-coms ruin us for love by propagating unrealistic and harmful ideas about what romance should look like.
And Take Two will argue that yes, rom-coms help us love by setting a high bar for the magic we should expect from relationships and modeling the personal growth necessary to actualize great love stories of our own.
I want to spend my life with you, even if it scares me, even if I'm as scared every day as I am right now.
And now, here's Take One. Rom-coms warp our expectations of love. Just listen to the research. Dr. Cheeky Davis writes, "Frequent viewers of romantic media content are less likely to believe that they can change themselves or their relationship, more likely to believe that their partner should intuitively understand their needs, and more likely to believe that sex should be perfect." They also report lower relationship satisfaction.
Whatever happened to chivalry? Does it only exist in 80s movies?
Rom-coms put grandiose hopes into viewers' heads that inevitably lead them to feel let down by real-life romance.
This is like a fairy tale. He saved your life, you dance under the stars, kiss in the rain.
Almost kissed.
This genre that is so completely detached from reality should be treated as escapist nonsense.
What if the fantasy actually became true and... what if there really is a handsome prince?
The basic formula of these stories is at odds with the mindset that's needed to be in an actual relationship. First, rom-coms encourage passivity in love by focusing on coincidence and fate rather than characters' agency.
The whole universe existed just to bring us together.
That's why I'm gonna let fate take me wherever it wants to go.
The couple is often brought together through heightened circumstances, rather than going on a series of dates and having that gradually develop into a relationship. Meanwhile, by emphasizing the idea of the one, the cosmic soulmate who is predestined for us, these movies reinforce the idea that if a relationship isn't effortless, it must be due to the other person being wrong, rather than a sign that we need to learn to compromise and work at things with our partner.
It implies there's some magical element that we have no control over, like fate or destiny. I think holding on to beliefs like that stops us doing the real work.
Of course, rom-coms do encourage some kinds of action. The problem is that these actions are largely negative.
Breaking and entering, that's a felony. I'm calling the sheriff.
The genre frequently excuses inexcusable behavior like lying, making callous bets, or manipulating in the name of love.
She's been pretending to be me, and I've been pretending to be her, and she's been catfishing you this entire time!
No.
And these creepy premises are glossed over at the end because it's all in service of bringing the couple together.
I get why you did it. I do. And honestly, had we not met the way that we had, maybe I wouldn't have noticed you.
Rom-coms are also known for romanticizing aggressive persistence.
I did it because I never stopped thinking about you. And if I didn't find you, I knew that my life would never ever be good again.
Dr. Julia R. Littman argues that watching this play out on screen can actually lead to an increase in stalking supportive beliefs.
Your name's Mary.
That's, distinctly weird. How do you know that?
Thus, viewers are led to excuse bad behaviors in themselves or toxic patterns from their partners, which should be deal breakers.
You were paid to take me out by the one person I truly hate. What was it like, a down payment now and then a bonus for sleeping with me?
For all their emphasis on finding love, rom-coms confuse us about who the one is. Many of these stories tell us that the right person for us is our polar opposite, and that constant clashing and bickering is what we should look for in a significant other, as it's supposedly a sign of repressed feelings.
Like, I very much hate him.
You're gonna have sex with him.
What?
Any tension is sexual tension.
Consequently, they dissuade us from seeking out a partner with similar interests and a compatible temperament, good foundations on which to build a solid and stable relationship. These movies also propagate the "he was in front of me all along" fallacy, where a character is somehow blind to their feelings until a crucial moment of epiphany.
I love you. I'm sorry it took so long for me to catch up.
In real life, the reason we're overlooking this person is because we're not actually interested in them. But rom-coms would have us believe that if we're not feeling the heat for our platonic friend, coworker, or acquaintance, maybe we're just wrong. So they lead us to distrust our most basic emotional instincts. Finally, the scope of love, as covered by the rom-com, is dangerously limited. The couple usually doesn't get together until the final scene, so these movies don't provide any guidance on how to make a relationship last. They're grounded in the exciting early stages of love, conveniently avoiding common struggles like boredom, incompatibility, and having the initial spark fizzle out.
You stopped having sex with me in the last year!
All things considered, the irony is that being a die-hard rom-com fan may leave you in a committed relationship with your screen rather than another person.
You're dating your computer? I've always wanted to have a wife without the challenges of actually dealing with anything real. I'm glad that you found someone.
And now for take two. Rom-coms guide us towards the love we deserve. Yes, rom-coms are aspirational. Why is that a bad thing? They embody the idea that you can't be what you can't see, painting a beautiful portrait of love that we can learn from and manifest in our own lives.
I just want to be with you. I want to make you laugh. I want you to call me out when I'm not pushing myself hard enough.
Most importantly, these movies send the message that we should hold out for true love and not settle.
You could not make me happy, and I'm convinced I'm the last woman in the world who could make you happy.
Watching our on-screen heroines hold out for the one, and inevitably find that person, inspires us to accept nothing less than fireworks ourselves.
You have bewitched me, body and soul, and I love, and love, and love you.
Rom-coms frequently debunk a character's overly pessimistic or fearful view of romance.
When it's real.
What? Is it scary?
Yeah.
These movies encourage self-examination, drawing our attention to the ways our own fears may be negatively informing our love lives and shutting out the positive potential that's there. As we watch characters push past their doubts in order to fully realize their love, we might be inspired to do the same.
And to have it all? We have to risk it all.
So contrary to Take One's argument, the genre underlines that the onus is ultimately on the protagonist to be active in the story by opening their heart and asserting their needs and desires.
I need you to know that I like you, Peter Kavinsky. And not in a fake way.
Meanwhile, any inappropriate moves the characters make in the name of love are usually regretted and atoned for.
We have faked their entire relationship.
It was never okay.
Far from endorsing bad behavior, rom-coms show the characters learning through their mistakes that this isn't how they should treat others, and suffering the fallout.
Look, Sierra, what you did was terrible. And I mean bad, like really bad. And
take My Best Friend's Wedding, a movie that is clearly critiquing its protagonist's dysfunctional and destructive antics as she tries to seduce her engaged friend.
You kissed him! At my parents' house! Oh. On my wedding day!
The he was right there phenomenon encourages us to broaden our view of who is a viable partner.
I'm just making some mental revisions to my perfect boyfriend checklist.
The red herring love interest who commonly shows up in these movies represents the character's superficial idea of the ideal mate.
She's a model.
That falls away as they mature and realize the deeper qualities that matter to them.
You and I, we never talk about anything.
So the lesson is that we're often fixating on the wrong things and ruling out great matches based on unimportant criteria.
Dating a guy who's shorter than me would just draw more attention to how much of a freak I am.
A crucial part of the character's journey comes through learning self-love.
Being tall actually is what makes me, and I like me.
To complete the narrative arc, they must figure out what they want out of their career and out of life.
But if I want to actually be a writer, I have to stop making excuses not to write.
Significantly, this personal growth is framed as key to achieving romantic satisfaction. In Dumplin', Willow Dean's insecurity about her appearance makes her shut out the conventionally attractive Beau.
You and I, we don't work together in the real world, Beau.
It's only after she's become more comfortable in her own skin that she's at last able to believe that Beau likes her. Meanwhile, To All the Boys, P.S. I Still Love You emphasizes that even after you've secured an extremely supportive, respectful, essentially perfect partner,
I don't want to rush you.
Underlying feelings of inadequacy aren't just going to magically disappear.
But for every first I was having with him, he'd already had his with her.
All this speaks to the reality that you can't fully trust another person's love for you if you don't love yourself.
I like you, Will.
Why?
Rom-coms warn us not to expect a love interest to make us whole, but to do that work on ourselves. And significantly, this work is internal. Often, the heroine's preoccupation with superficial changes she thinks she needs to make to be more attractive is revealed not to matter at all.
I like you very much, just as you are.
Ultimately, when we're in the dating trenches and need hope to go on, the rom-com offers valuable reassurance that love is out there. Movies with darker takes on relationships simply aren't going to sustain or motivate us in the search for a partner. In fact, they may well do the opposite.
And then all we did was resent each other and try to control each other and cause each other pain.
That's marriage.
Back to take one. The rom-com formula is inherently restrictive. Even if a rom-com contains more enlightened messages or critiques, these are undermined by the very structure of the genre, which almost always culminates in the happy ending of a romantic union.
I'd always fantasized about falling in love in a field.
The protagonist may have to learn to love herself first, as Take Two suggests, but this is undercut by the way the story still holds up a man's commitment as the ultimate prize to reward that self-improvement. Shaping the entire story as a build-up to a romantic moment underscores the idea that the journey to happiness is only complete once we've settled into a traditional monogamous partnership.
I want to be with you for the rest of my life, Angie.
That was actually all pretty traditional.
The rom-com frames a woman being single or uninterested in settling down as a problem to be fixed. And through this lens, the only natural resolution to this conflict is having her finish the story in love. This is encapsulated in Runaway Bride, where Maggie's ambivalence towards marriage has led her to abandon several different men at the altar. Because her romantic anxiety is pathologized rather than taken as a sign that she just shouldn't get married, it follows that the culmination of her story has her finally going through with a wedding, the implication being that she's been cured.
Maggie Carpenter got married.
A similar setup plays out in movies focused on ambitious working women, where the character's dedication to her career is treated as a defect.
My closest relationship is with my BlackBerry.
Thank God it vibrates.
And the solve is her learning to dial it back for love.
Yeah, so who's boss, Andrew?
This genre may be primarily marketed to women, but it's not really serving them with its vanilla, heteronormative, one-size-fits-all formula.
The moment you're craving isn't anchored in real emotion. It's a script dictated to you by our society's patriarchal love narrative.
Rom-coms harm their core demographic by forcing everyone down the same narrow path towards monogamy, ignoring that some people might prefer to continue playing the field or prioritizing their careers. As a result, it can end up guiding us away from what's most likely to bring us happiness as individuals. Telling a woman that she's failed or incomplete if she hasn't yet found someone can also lead to her caring so much about love that ironically, she ends up sabotaging her chance at it.
I don't know this woman, okay? We went on one date. One. She's a stalker.
Rom-coms create an obsessive romance-chasing drive in viewers that can manifest in them aggressively seeking someone who perfectly checks all their boxes. Crazy Ex-Girlfriend exemplifies this through Rebecca, a successful lawyer who pins all her hopes of happiness on a pretty underwhelming guy after a chance encounter.
I was in New York, I ran into Josh, he made me feel warm inside, like glitter was exploding inside me, then I moved here.
As the show progresses, we see that this fixation leads not to everlasting love, but an escalating mental health crisis.
People in romantic comedies generally are psychotic. And then we said, okay, if this took place in reality, what would this person be like? And the first answer was she would be dreadfully unhappy.
We'd be a lot better equipped to find a healthy balance of romance in our lives if rom-coms stopped presenting it as the be-all and end-all and offered us a wider variety of paths leading to personal fulfillment.
The thing about being single is you should cherish it.
Now it's Take Two's turn. The rom-com is actually innovative and edgy. This genre is a lot more subversive than Take One gives it credit for, and includes many beloved movies that are known for complicating viewers' expectations.
Maybe there will be sex. But by God, there'll be dancing.
take someone great as a recent example. As Jenny reels from a breakup with her longtime boyfriend Nate, it emerges that the truly enduring love story here is between her and her two best friends.
I don't know life without this.
Moreover, the completion of Jenny's journey is her getting excited about a future with herself, not Nate.
I met you when everything was new and exciting, and the possibilities of the world seemed endless. And they still are. For you, for me, but not for us.
As screenwriter and director Jennifer Caton Robinson explained about the title, at the beginning you think someone great is Nate, but at the end you realize it's Jenny. The rom-com formula continues to evolve thanks to both sequels and TV shows. Thanks to their longer timelines, these stories get to explore what happens after the honeymoon phase is over, as the characters grapple with romantic disillusionment and grow from it.
I wanted something that doesn't exist. I wanted happily ever after.
We've also started to see more rom-coms centering queer characters and people of color, and this has real impact in a world that has historically presented the ideal mate as straight and white.
I did read somewhere that the people that do worst on the apps are Asian men and black women.
Well, it's great white people finally have an advantage somewhere.
And there's an ever-growing subgenre of self-aware rom-coms like 500 Days of Summer and Isn't It Romantic that deconstruct tropes and correct many of the more problematic messages these movies used to send.
Why are you talking like that?
Talking like what?
Like an offensive version of a gay guy.
This girl thing bouffant, please.
But even when the genre isn't actively subverting our expectations, it's still capable of opening our eyes to the bigger picture. Take one is overthinking the impact of the story structure on viewers. Because we usually know what will happen in the end, the couple will get together, the fun comes from the journey there. This is why rom-coms are so associated with witty banter, entertaining side characters, the chemistry between the leads, and the hijinks that ensue. Finding love and finding yourself is an ongoing process, and the rom-com is there to help us enjoy it.
So what's your stance on rom-coms?
Tell us whether Take One or Take Two has you convinced.
And be sure to subscribe to Netflix Film Club.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.